28 miles of shoreline, its magnificent beaches, and its opportunity for water sports of all kinds. In the next half hour, we're going to take a look at some of the people and places and festivities that make Detroit Lakes, Minnesota, the unique spot it is. It's all here, all year. That's the slogan the Chamber of Commerce uses to advertise this city. From the magnificent colors of fall to the winter sports of skiing, ice fishing, and snowmobiling. But it's the summer season that brings Detroit Lakes alive. The population of 7,000 swells to more than double that number with the influx of cottage owners and visitors. And it all started almost 115 years ago. People first started coming to Detroit Lakes in significant numbers in 1871. That's the year the city was founded. It was called Detroit in those days. The name is from the Ojibwe Indian language and means lake in which there is a crossing on a sandy place. The city's founder was a Massachusetts native named Colonel George Henry Johnston. He worked for the New England Company and was sent into the area to find a site for colonization. He chose 10,000 acres in Becker County. The original name for the town was Detroit Lake, but the people quickly changed that to Detroit. In the 1880s, it was also known as Detroit City. And some area residents that were vying for the county seat to be located in their town gave it less flattering names, names like Swamp Town, Sloughville, and Mudville. In 1926, a vote of the people gave the city its present name. Much of the history of Detroit Lakes has been chronicled by the Detroit Record, a paper described 100 years ago as a live weekly paper working for the interests of Becker County. In 1880, the paper carried a column describing the services available. By then, the town had grown to 800 people. In the words of the writer, the town boasted a large and commodious school building that accommodated a grade school and a high school. The story added that Baptists, Congregationalists, and Methodists have large congregations and commodious church edifices. There was a bank, a brickyard that turned out 20,000 brick a day, and a number of meeting halls. And there was a post office that sent out mail four times a day by train to points east and west. The area was also a haven for fishermen, and the paper reported, and these were the words, "The lake abounds in bass, pickerel, pike, and whitefish, and the lovers of the piscatorial have a chance to gratify themselves by large hauls, either by trolling or still fishing with a rod and line." The record also mentioned three mineral springs near the banks of the lake that send forth their waters and plead for the tired and weary to come and quaff of the life-giving tonic. The 1880 account cited a need for a hotel to accommodate the growing number of visitors to the city, and that need was met in 1884 with the building of the picturesque Minnesota Hotel, an impressive four-story structure. That hotel was destroyed by fire in 1915. It was another in a series of spectacular blazes that took many of the city's early buildings. Otto Zeck, curator for the Becker County Historical Society, recalls the aftermath of the Minnesota Hotel fire.
I didn't see that from my farm out there, but I remember after the fire, probably the next day or so, there was the basement there with the ashes in there smoking like everything's still burning. Minnesota was a northwest wind blowing that day too, and the fire brands went clear across Detroit Lake and across the lake south side there. They had to watch down there so the cottages didn't set on fire.
The previous year, 1914, the hot, dry winds fanned another blaze that leveled half a dozen buildings. Zeck, barely 5 years old at the time, recalls that blaze.
That's the big fire in 1914 in August there. And the fire started in Rames Livery Barn. And it spread to the fire hall there, the city hall, that was made out of wood. And from there, it spread over to the Methodist Church, the old Methodist Church there, which Jesse Nunn was using as a undertaking parlor and a furniture store. And at the next picture down there, you'll see there it's burning. And you see George Peoples' bookstore there, Bazaar, and down there, there George Peoples' store, the whole thing is burned down. There's only the John H. Smith Company that stood by on the corner, and Morby Stores left there. And back there's the parking lot and the old upper house. The upper house is over here in this picture here. It's burning, but what's burning there is the Sheridan Hotel. I think it's the Sheridan Hotel burning there. And then there was 500 cords of cordwood piled in there in that parking lot where the parking lot is today yet, for fuel for the light plant and for the flour mill. And when the fire got in that, it made one hot fire. Yeah. And
how long did it burn? How long did they fight the fire, do you remember?
Well, all that day, and most they had to watch it for days afterwards, yep. And you see what the Detroit Lakes Fire Department, right there it is, that hose cart, that's all the engine they had.
That's all they had?
That's all they had, and the water tank didn't give enough pressure so they could get the water up on the second story. But the Frazee had bought a brand new pumper truck, you know, and they put it on the railroad train, flat car, and railroad brought it up here, and they helped them fight the fire.
What started the fire?
Well, they said a hobo started the fire in Rame's livery barn. I'm sleeping up in Haymow.
Did they ever prove that?
No.
In the years before Henry Ford and his Model T were to change the travel habits of the country, boats of all shapes and sizes were a means of doing business and offering recreation on the area lakes. The Robert Fulton and the Minnie Corliss were familiar sights at the turn of the century.
John K. West, a pioneer in the city of Detroit, saw a need for a way of getting the tourists coming into the city from the train depot to the resorts that began to spring up on the lower lakes. The Pelican Valley Navigation Company built a system of locks, the Dunton locks at the inlet to Lake Sally, the Kingsbury locks at the outlet of Buck Lake, and the Johnson locks located in the Pelican River itself, closer to Pelican Lake. In order to make these locks work, Mr. West found it necessary to dredge the Pelican River canal that connected all of these lakes. This system was used each year between the years 1890 and 1918. 1918 brought about the demise of the canal system because of improved roads and improved automobiles. The canal boats that were no longer used were taken over to a bay on Muskrat Lake where they were sunk. They remained there pretty much intact for many years until World War II, when all of the steam boilers and all of the metal was salvaged for them for the war effort. This was an era that really gave Detroit Lakes its reputation as a tourist town, a tourist area. That reputation continues today.
Detroit Lakes is a very beautiful place. Mainly, we're a resort community. We have a lot of recreational facilities that tourists can come and enjoy. We estimate that our population probably doubles in the area during the summer months. As far as the business climate is concerned, of course, the businessmen probably enjoy most of their profits in the summertime because their business isn't quite as lively in the winter. As far as problems that we incur, there's some problems with police protection, things like that, where we have to beef up our police force slightly in the summertime. And we employ a lot of people in the summertime to take care of the parks and recreation facilities. But other than that, we don't really have to gear up too much for anything special. Right now, this fall, we're hoping to break ground on a new mall project for a redevelopment of our downtown business district. We hope to take an entire block and basically renovate the entire thing. We'll be using some of the existing buildings in the project, and we'll be tearing down a lot of buildings and reconstructing brand new.
We have a very enthusiastic community. Our slogan is, it's all here, all year, and when you take on a project, if you want help, you can get it. Lots of cooperation. This community has motion. You know, it just comes with the lakes. We were blessed with the lakes. We didn't create the lakes. And we're capitalizing on those lakes. We're attracting people. The people who live here are enjoying the lakes. And we work to make the area a more beautiful place to live and do business for the tourists as well as the people that live here 12 months a year. When I first moved here, people said, well, you know, they just roll up the streets in the winter. And I explain it this way. Detroit Lakes becomes a normal community in the winter. We're so active during the summer months, the population doubles to triples. During the winter, we're also active. In fact, we're more action-oriented than most communities, such as downhill skiing, cross-country skiing. Curling's become a big thing here now. We're attracting conventions. Getaway weekends, people like to come to the Holiday Inn and get away. I think they appreciate the lakes. You know, we have 412 lakes within 25 miles. If you want to go fishing, the fishing aren't biting at one lake, you're only a cast away from another lake. The golf courses. We have four beautiful golf courses. Go golfing here, the tips. Some golf courses are more than the green fees in Detroit Lakes.
The Sioux Pass Ranch has been around here for over 40 years. 30 or 40 years. It's been a working ranch for that long, meaning it's always had horse rides, trail breakfast, campouts, cabins. Mainly what we've done is sort of given it spring cleaning. Redid all the cabins, the showers, put in the beer bar, the saloon, opened up the barn dancing, new campfire area, opened up some new campgrounds. Those are some of the things that we've added. We're not trying to change the tradition of the Dude Ranch, because it has a long tradition and it's been in this area for a long time. So I don't know how much we've really changed anything. I think we're adding to it. We want to keep the rustic look about the ranch. You want to keep it natural. The Sioux Pass is beautiful property, and it's flanked by two lakes. We've added the Wee Fest. Actually, the Wee Fest is added, it's kind of twofold. The Dude Ranch has been here for years and had a beautiful bowl, natural bowl. And when we selected the site for the Wee Fest, one of the reasons was its beauty. People come here and they can camp on 271 acres and listen to country music. Matter of fact, it's a feast of country music, 27 hours, 3 days long. And last year we did about 90,000 people. In our first year, about 30,000 people attended. Last year was about 90,000. And this year we expect the same. And we offer a place to get away and kick back, or we offer a big entertainment night, a lot of music, and a place for people from all over the United States to get away and kick back. And a lot of people love coming out.
Water Carnival, the first annual, was held on June 30th, 1935 as a one-day event, and it has grown to a three-day event, a 10-day event, which we now know it as, and of course with the 50th Northwest Water Carnival being held 10 days. They had the foresight to, at that time, to put together the Water Carnival, and at the beginning it was held down along the beach. Of course, all the events were water related. And then over the years, we added different events and included things that were held on the street. And today we now have special events and things that don't necessarily relate to water, but they are part of the water carnival. It has grown to the point now where we enjoy the senior chamber has helped us coordinate things for the water carnival, where in the early days, the junior chamber and the senior chamber were fighting, and simply because of the unions that were in town and things that were happening, the senior chamber did not like the idea of a junior chamber being started. And over the years, those things changed, and now we rely on the senior chamber to help us out. I feel the water carnival means a lot to the Detroit Lakes area because of the tourists that it attracts, the number of people, the number of families that come back year after year after year. They make reservations before the 50th is even over with. There are questions being asked by those people as to when is the 51st going to be held, and they want to know what the dates are. So to the Detroit Lakes area, I think it means tradition. It means bringing people back that do not live in the area, but they feel at home when they come to the water carnival. People remember coming to Detroit Lakes for the water carnival over the years and taking in things like the pavilion.
The pavilion was built in 1915 primarily as a dance hall for people all around the area of Detroit Lakes. They came from Fargo, old Pelican Rapids, Fergus Falls, well, Minneapolis, wherever they were from, you know, they'd come to the pavilion and stay here in a Saturday night dance. And back in the 40s, I know they had dime a dance. You'd go in the pavilion, and during that time, you couldn't get on the dance floor unless you paid a dime to get on the dance floor. So that kind of made it fun. And all through those years, you had big bands, big name bands and whatnot going on. The pavilion during the 50s, it was quite a place to go to. You had everybody from all over would go there then, and it was the hop of the 50s. You couldn't walk in the place. In Detroit Lakes, you couldn't move. That was the place to go. Bobby V, he started there at the pavilion, and he's been playing now for the JC's Water Carnival over quite a few years now.
First time I played here was 1959, and it seemed a lot bigger then. 1959, I had a record out called Susie Baby, which was our first regional record, and it was a big hit, and we came into the Detroit Lakes Pavilion with our little PA system, and the kids that came in that night were virtually that. They were teenagers. It was one of the great teen dance spots in the entire upper Midwest. It was in the top 10, absolutely. In fact, I think you could probably talk to any of the artists from the 50s and 60s, and they will tell you about places that we took for granted: the Crystal Ballroom, the Detroit Lakes Pavilion, the Maple Lake Pavilion, Balmoral, some of these little hole-in-the-wall places that were just great fun, and they got some of the best acts that we're touring. It probably sounds better now than it ever did because of when we first started coming through, we had a little PA system about the size of my watch. And we would put a speaker up on each side, and it was echoing, and I don't think anybody really cared. You know, the records that were made in the 50s were kind of basement type records, garage sounding records. And now, of course, with the sophistication of the 80s, it's really not a very big room anymore. It's pretty intimate.
Well, just in the past year, the Detroit Lakes JCs have acquired the pavilion from the city, and we plan on, the Detroit Lakes JCs, plan on restoring the pavilion and having dances there once again, and redoing it as a community center for other groups to use and anybody to have dances in there, and a place for, well, the new generation to see what the old generation had for going for it.
The Parade of the Northwest has been held since 1938, which was the third year that we ran the Water Carnival. And it has grown from a few units those first few years to what we now classify. We feel we've got the best parade anywhere.
Thank you. Thank you.